Hello and welcome once again to the Domino Theory Television Program. My name's Gil Francis and I will be your host. Today is the 3rd of February 2015 and we have just begun to celebrate Black History Month over the weekend. I would like to give my kudos to Mr. Larry Gray of the Association of Midnight Basketball League and the teachers group that participated in the essay and breakfast contest. There were three, I think, prizes given away for essays written, one for 1500, one for 1000, one for 500. And that's what I'm talking about when we talk about putting your money where your mouth is. I think that'll help these kids out in their educational endeavors, and we should be doing more investing in our young people and especially in their educational needs. Our school system throughout the nation is lacking in that area, and it dismays me the fact that we build more prisons than we do schools. But it is, as I said before, what it is. So we have to deal with it and deal with it as best we can. We took a trip recently down to New Orleans, Louisiana to visit some relatives and see what was happening in the hometown. Basically things are the same. The geographics of course have been changed since that Katrina hurricane some years ago. Very little has been done in the direction of rebuilding certain areas of the city, which I'm sure is by design, but New Orleans is New Orleans and it's always been New Orleans. The music, the food, the facade of all this great happiness. It was actually one of the slave capitals of the world. The French Market is where slaves were sold down in Jackson Square. And very little is said about that. A lot is said about the dancing that went on during that period of time where in Congo Square, where the African Americans would gather, weren't allowed to on Sunday afternoons to parade and let off a little steam, I guess. And the owners or people in power or powers that be will come out and use this as entertainment. And I have nothing wrong with a good show, but there are ways to put on a good show also. And as a future promoter, I guess I would want to do it in a much better vein. I do ramble sometimes, but you have to put up with me. Anyway, while in the New Orleans area, I was able to visit, along with a relative, we went up to Donaldsonville, Louisiana, and I don't know how many of you are familiar with the state of Louisiana, but Donaldsonville is located in Ascension Parish. Louisiana is the only state that has parishes left in the country. Everybody else has counties, but in Louisiana, they're called parishes, but they're the same thing as a county. And why that still exists, I have no idea whatsoever, but they've hung on to it, and that's what it is. But anyway, Donaldsonville, located in Ascension Parish, is where we visited the River Road African American Museum, which was put together, founded by Miss Kathy Hamburg Jackson. And we'd like to thank Miss Jackson very much for having us come down and visit with her. She wasn't available due to illness, but we hope that she's okay now, and we once again like to thank her and her associate curator, Miss Janice Linton. She was a very good hostess and a wonderful curator, and she gave us some just facts that we really enjoyed finding out about and delving into the artifacts that were in the museum were just absolutely fantastic. And it's not a great, big, beautiful museum with concrete and glass and all this stuff. It's a little old house out in the country, if you will, and it tells you a lot about where you came from. Now, a lot of us deny our kinship to each other, but when you get down to the facts, we're all related. We have so many people named Smith, so many people named Johnson, so many people named this and that. But can you imagine the fact that we all came from somebody's plantation and that person's name was given to us and we were dispersed amongst the population and hence we have cousins, 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 and more cousins, even cousins that we some care about, some that we don't care too much about, but that's neither here nor there. As I said, I do ramble on occasion. But anyway, as we celebrate Black History Month, I want to make you aware of the fact that at Hamilton Recreation Center on the 28th of the month, February 2015, we will be having our annual Black History celebration, which entails participation by young folks in the community. And hopefully this time we'll have some older people come and help us out with our celebration also. If you have any ideas or if you would like to volunteer or to help out or come be a part of it or just come take a look, you're more than welcome. And as I said, it's on the 28th, which is the last Saturday of February. And we are having our celebration along with some mighty good food. And you might meet some people that are of interest to you that are very interesting people. Anyway, the museum that we went to visit is called the River Road African American Museum. And it is located on St. Charles Street in the city of Donaldsonville. And you know, as I drove along the countryside and saw the sugarcane fields, I couldn't help but think about the past. And you know, you can say what you want, but those people that came before us, the older people that came before us, were really indulgent and dare to be reverent because they had a lot of obstacles to face. And I think they did a wonderful job because we're still here. What happens with the next generation is a whole nother show and a whole nother topic. But as I see it, we were very fortunate, we being people in my age group in their 60s and early 70s, that we were raised at the time that we were by the people that we were, because those people really and honestly cared about us. I was thinking about one of the security questions on my iCloud, whatever application was, who was your favorite elementary school teacher? And I had no problem hesitating. There were three, actually, and I remembered all of them because they were very sincere about what they taught and the way that they taught it. Unfortunately, none of the stuff that I am about to show you, or very little of it, was ever taught in the classrooms of the schools that I attended. And this being public or private schools, we just didn't get this type of information. I don't particularly I don't know, how would I put it? I don't particularly care for the fact that our history books have been altered as much as they have, or we should say, having materials left out. I do think the answer now is charter schools, but that's not going to bring all the information that has been lost or hidden or distorted back, but I think that it's a start. Most people that sit on school boards, I don't know if this is a just statement or not, but I don't think they have children in school. Maybe they did at one time, and maybe they do. I have no idea, but I don't think that they have a vested interest in what actually happens to our children in school. You know, when I came here in 1957, making a transformation from the Southern school system in New Orleans and this school system in San Francisco was quite overwhelming at one point, because the teachers, it was just different. As I said before, the teachers that I had in Louisiana were very sort of like more family, and it was of course segregated, and we had all black teachers, and that I don't know if it attributed to learning any more or any less, but that was a fact. And coming into an integrated school system, I can surely say was somewhat of a shock to me, and I managed to deal with it fortunately and move on with the educational aspect of my life. And I hope that you young people will follow suit. No one said it was easy, and it isn't. Life at times can be quite challenging, but we have to face those challenges, and as you can see from some of the film and information I'm about to disseminate to you, that those people that came back during those times, man, what a time they faced. And I am so glad now that while we face these type of obstacles in certain areas, it is not as, or maybe it is, as blatant as it was at one time. I look at the political situation now, and I often have to wonder, is politicking actually pandering? Because most of the politicians have to go out and beg, basically, for people to support them in their work. And I'm sure that those people that support them expect something in return, and most of them do, from what I understand, get it. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. These pictures that I'm going to show you, and this lady that I'm going to talk to, Miss Linton, very informative, and we appreciate the time that was taken out to give us this tour. You yourself can contact the African American River Road Museum located in Donaldsonville, Louisiana. On YouTube, you can go on the internet, and you can make reservations to go down and visit if you're going to be in the New Orleans area. It's only about an hour's trip from New Orleans, and I think it's a very worthwhile trip. I would like to see all middle school and high school classes take a mandatory trip to tour this facility. And it's that strong, my belief in this facility is that strong because of what it shows you and what it exposes people to. A lot of stuff that I grew up with, like old ice boxes, and it's just amazing. It's really incredible that all of these things have been saved. And we hope that you will enjoy our presentation. We have some more film, but we couldn't do it in this 1 hour. So we're going to have a follow-up program in which we will show you the remainder, hopefully, of some of the footage that we were able to attained while we were in Louisiana. We'll be back. Ladies and gentlemen, we're coming to you this morning from Donaldsonville, Louisiana. And before us is a tribute located in the Bicentennial Jazz Plaza, which is an intricate part of Donaldsonville, Louisiana. Jazz was developed at the turn of the 20th century in South Louisiana and was born from a combination of musical traditions, work songs, spirituals, blues, and ragtime. From the early days of vaudeville and minstrel shows to the formidable first years of jazz, Donaldsonville was a hotbed of musical activity. Many of the early musicians developed an interest and talent while living on or near the plantations in the rural communities of Ascension Parish. This bicentennial monument serves as a site of enduring significance that documents, preserves, and celebrates the rural musicians, famous and unsung, from this region. It also stands as a monument in recognition of the people and neighborhoods that nourish these musicians and laid the foundation for jazz that carved a uniquely prominent position on the world stage. Donaldsonville and Ascension Parish are fortunate to have these notable musicians as native sons, such people as Claiborne Williams, Joseph King Oliver, William Foster, Richard Miney Jones, George Pops Foster, Davidson C. Nelson, and Emmanuel Sales. This monument was erected by the city of Donaldsonville. It's also a part of Donaldsonville history. This is called the River Road African American Museum, and it's located on Charles Street in Donaldsonville. So if you're ever in the area, I suggest highly that you come by and take a look. We're going to go inside and tour the museum, but I wanted to give you an overview of the outside of the building. It's a rather older house, but it's been renovated and it's all a part of history, our history, here in southern Louisiana. Headed by the sign ahead of us, the River Road African American Museum is dedicated to collecting, preserving, and educating and interpreting art, artifacts, and buildings as they relate to the history of African Americans in the rural communities along the Mississippi River. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we are here, of course, in Donaldsonville, Louisiana, which is not too far from my hometown, but far enough away. Anyway, we're going to take a tour of the African American Museum, which is here, and we're going to talk to a young lady who is a curator, one of the curators of the museum. Good morning, how are you?
I'm just great, sir. How are you?
Good. Would you like to introduce yourself to our audience?
Good morning. My name is Janice H. Linton. I'm from Donaldsonville, Louisiana. I was born and reared here, finished high school here, and now I'm a curator here at the River Road African American Museum, which was founded by Miss Kathy Hambry Jackson.
Uh-huh. So how long have you done this?
I've been here about 12 years. I've been doing this for 12 years.
And you were telling me outside, I think, your educational background is?
I finished high school from Laurie High School in Donaldsonville, Louisiana, which was founded by Dr. Laurie, one of the richest black doctors and the first black doctor here in Donaldsonville in Ascension Parish. And he was the one that donated money to Ascension Parish School Board to pay black teachers to teach black students. Then he turned around and donated land so that they can build a building for high school students here in Donaldsonville.
I can't imagine that he's no longer with us.
No, he's not. He's passed on.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. So are you still teaching or?
No, I'm not a teacher. Well, per se. I volunteer in the foster grandparents program at Laura Elementary School, and I'm also a tutor at the school as well. I do after-school tutoring with Bright Future, a program, federal funded program that Ms. Donna Gagnon had written for the city of Donaldsonville here in Ascension Parish.
So you have been a lifelong resident of Donaldsonville?
Yes, I have.
I understand. And you also mentioned something about you have, what, 11 brothers and sisters?
Now I have four. Seven of us left. No, it's nine, because two died. It's nine of us left. Yeah, I came from a large family.
I can understand that, yeah. I coming through Donaldsonville as a younger person from Patterson, we used to come up and play basketball. As I told you before, we didn't win very many games up here, but that was okay. We enjoyed the bus ride. Yeah, but I would love to see the rest of this, so we're going to let you show us what you show people on tours.
Okay. This is the Red Room. This is the first room that you would enter when you enter to the museum. The Red Room is called We Be Free, because these are where they have the one ads of being free. Free people, and you have pictures of people, free people of color. In the Red Room, we also have a kiosk with different segments on it. You will be able to choose and watch whatever segment you want to meet, you want to see. Also, we have quotes. Rather die freeman live than live to be a slave, by Henry Hannah Garnet. We have a determination, and this is what we have to teach our children, to be determined to do the right thing and to be positive. Around. Now we have the panel that people can come from all over the world and see their family name on these panels. And the numbers behind the name are not just numbers, those are the ages. We had children as young as 2 months old that was enslaved.
That is incredible.
Yes. And a lot of the children don't understand and be saying, that's not true. And I tell them, yes, it is for real. You know, and they had one Mr. Colliver, as old as 95 years old, was still a slave on the plantation.
You are watching a list of slaves, and next to these slaves, you see numbers. These numbers are their ages. Go ahead.
We're entering into the kitchen. The kitchen is where all the delicious food was prepared by our ancestors. Here, we have an icebox. Years ago, when we grew up, we had a white one, but it wasn't like this. This is a furniture. This is part of a furniture.
Mm-hmm.
An icebox where you put ice in it. It's a wooden box. And the ice would stay in there for about 3 days. The ice man would come around, and they would purchase the ice, and they would always wrap it in white cloth. And the holes would be draining holes for the water. These are curtains. I don't know if they still makes it in the sacks. Rice and sugar was sold in these sacks. Now, the old folks always took the sacks and opened them up, made clothing as well as they used them for curtains. It was so many things that they took and used for the use around the house. Here, we have the word gumbo. Gumbo in Africa, that's what the word gumbo mean in Africa, gumbo. Gumbo was brought to America. The ones from Africa brought here, we have okra. These are called longhorn okra. They were brought, the seeds was brought from Africa in the women's hair. They had real thick hair and they would put the seeds in their hair and they would bring the okra, they brought the okra over to the United States of America. Here is a stove, a cast iron stove, a wooden stove, where they would use to cook with. And over here we have a pot that we use as on a farm when they would have to cook on a Monday. They would cook one pot of beans. They would cook a pot of beans. They would put that pot of beans on and they would wash. On a Monday they wash and they always cook red beans and rice on a Monday. The reason why they would wash, they cook red beans because that was the only day they washed for everybody on the plantation. And today yet, at the Black University, we still serve red beans and rice on Mondays. This is called a washboard. This is the occupant soap that they used years ago that they used to wash the clothes with, you bathe with, and you also wash your hair with it. And I think they still sell it in the store. But the washboard is what the old folks used to wash on. And now it's used for zydeco music. I can't remember the man name who invented the zydeco music with the washboard. These are called butter churns. The butter churns, you would take the clabber from the milk, you let the milk clabber, and then you would take it and put it into this, and you would churn it, and it would come out butter. Over here, these are called bay leaves. They have dried and stuff, but it's just like a medicine, because everything that we used, it comes from the earth. And our medicine comes from the earth. But now we have so many side effects, we don't know what we're taking. Over here is the cast iron pot that they use now. They call it jambalaya pot because everybody uses this to make jambalaya. But when we was growing up as children, our dad and our great uncles would use this when they had a hog killing. And they would make crackling. They would cook the head and all that in here. And our grandparents would take and make hog head cheese. And we had all of that. This is a sign from New Orleans. I got watermelon and apple. I got okra. I got onions and garlic. See, they had a fruit man would pass around, and they would be announcing what they were selling, and everybody would run to the street to buy bananas, apples, oranges, and all that from the, because it was fresh from the fruit man. Over here is a rug beater, that wire rug beater, what they used to do clean the rugs and stuff with years ago, as well as this beater. This is an egg beater. This is what they used to use to beat the meringue for lemon pie. And they had to beat the white of the egg until this beater stood up and it's stiff. Also on this wall, we have the Black inventors and their inventions. This is a list of some of the people, Black people, of the inventions that our people invented. On here, we have something now that we use it every day. People don't leave their house without it. Even in the car, they're on the cell phone. This wall as well, we also have, recipes about pepper, corn, deep frying, and peanuts. Also, over here we have the picture of Dr. George Washington Carver, 1864 to 1943. Dr. George Washington Carver had found so many things that you can use peanuts for, over 300 or 3,000 things that he used that we're able to identify with as of today.
Now, we just went over this list of Black inventors and inventions. When I was coming up in school, the only people that we really knew about invented anything was Dr. George Washington Carver. I didn't know that list was that long.
I'm telling you, you know, and look, paper, chess, see all these games, all these smart things, you know, brainy things. Our people did this, you know. Civilization African, you know, aerial plane, propeller, James John Adams.
That's fantastic.
You see, we have all kinds of things. We have with his nail brush, Lydia Newman. We have the cellular phone, Henry Sampson. We have all automatic gear shift, RB speed.
That is incredible.
This is our people.
Yeah.
You know, even down to the simplest little thing is the wrench. Our people invented this. Now, if we don't tell our children this, who else will?
That's absolutely true.
That's true. Who else will? Yeah. And you see, and I always heard Maya Angelou say, when you know more and you do better, you do better.
Yeah.
Right.
And if we inform our children and educate our children about this, these things, they would want to do better.
They would want to study and learn those things.
Yeah.
That's exactly right. Well,
they working for people, but your forefathers are the one that invented it. You should be on top, not them.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right.
Okay, what else do we have?
Okay, well, Maya Angelou. We have a Malaika Faber, right, an artist from here in Ascension Parish. She did this picture as well as she did this sack up here.
Mm-hmm.
But over here is the regular cotton sack that the women had to pick. 100 pounds of cotton, and they were paid 3 cents. This was the sack that they would have to pick cotton with. And then they would drag this cotton behind them, this sack behind them. They're working in the fields. And if they had a child, they would carry that child, the one that they had in the arm, they would have it carried across their chest. That's right. And the other one, a toddler, would be at the end of the sack, and they would pull that child along with them as they would pick cotton.
Okay, hold up.
Made out of cornmeal. And then hokey was meal mix with water in a thick batter. It got its name because it was fried on the blade of a hoe over an open fire. Today they can be cooked in big iron pan, something like that, or on, you know, in the oven, two or three at a time. And they're served with these seafood platters, and they're called hush puppies.
Yeah.
And the hush puppies was given to the slaves when they were running away from the plantation. The cornmeal was given to them, and the old folks would tell them, now you keep this and don't eat all of it. So in case the hound dogs get too close, you can break it off and throw it to them. And when you do that, you say hush puppy, and that means for them, you know. So once you wet cornmeal, it swells up, so they wouldn't be able to bark after them anymore.
Hmm. And this, of course, is those one of those stoves.
Yes, this is a kerosene stove.
Yes, indeed.
Mm-hmm. 1940s.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, this is where it all happened. That it was in the kitchen, as I recall.
Oh, yes.
That's where the heat was.
Yes.
That's fantastic. Go.
We're entering the yellow room. This room is called the Reconstruction in Politics, the Louisiana Inventors as well. In this room, you'll find the Promised Land. Okay, we find the original picture by, it's a newspaper from the newspaper London in 1878. This is an original article. Over here we have the proclamation as well, original document. We also have a proclamation of emancipation by Abraham Lincoln. On this wall, we have Reconstruction. Would you believe at one time it was really run by blacks? We had one from Louisiana, from Ascension Parish, Mr. Louis Butler, as well. This whole thing was the state of Louisiana back in 1868. Under this picture, we had our PBS Pinchback, first black lieutenant governor, of the state of Louisiana in 1872, PBS Pinchback. When I said politics, we had politics.
Yeah, but look at the color of him. He don't look
bad. This is Mr. Pierre Carlisle Landry, first black elected mayor in the United States of America, was here in Donaldsonville, Louisiana in 1868. We have a bust also that was done by Dr. E.J. Jordan from Southern University in New Orleans, Louisiana. Pierre Carlisle Landry served as in many capacities. He also founded the United Methodist Church here in Donaldsonville, Louisiana, which is located around the corner on Tallahatchie Street. He was elected mayor, and he was passed. Madam, this is Madam C.J. Walker. She was the first black millionaire anywhere, black or white. We have a picture.
And she did our hair products?
Hair products. Also, cosmetics in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
What year was that?
1917.
And she brought other black people together, or was it mixed? Or?
Oh, yes. Also, as Madame Piro, Poro, was part of her schooling as well. And this is Madame C.J. Walker. This also is Madame C.J. Walker. And her car is
Look at her.
And everybody was wondering, how can you become a millionaire? And at that time, they didn't have no mail carriers and, you know, in that time and stuff. But what we must remember, too, we are people who are survivors.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Absolutely.
This is for her. Maybe more hard to be left out of this.
For sure.
Also, this is a Louisiana Antebellum home map, an original copy.
I took a picture of that one. Yeah, but you can still
right here.
Go ahead. Madam C.J. Walker. I don't know if that was her home or not. This is the Antebellum, a map of the state of Louisiana, Antebellum homes. It goes all over. The Mississippi River runs all the way down here to the bayou, to the Gulf.
Could you tell me a little bit about what the meaning of antebellum is? Is that like a plantation? Or?
Yes, antebellum is a plantation home that was built on the plantation, the big white house they called them. And they have them now where they use them as bed and breakfast.
Yeah.
And like down at Laura Plantation, they have the one at Maywood Plantation.
In Thibodeau?
Yes.
Yeah, I've seen they got all the plantation houses and everything still down there.
Still, So they use them to do tours and things, you know,
that's
tourism.
What they do it down there.
Yes, tourism.
Now I wanted to ask you also, in my brief studies of African American history, I understand that there were also some black people that were slave owners also. Is that?
Yes, that is so true. Clementine Hunter was a slave owner, a black person of color, and she had I wonder if it's still, right now I can't think of it. I'm going to get the name and stuff for you. But they were. They had, like Mother used to always say, don't ever fool yourself. Whatever white people have doing now, black people have already done.
Yeah.
All right. You know, keep that in mind.
So,
thank you.
And on this map, you have all the little cities, all the town, you know, all the bayous, the rivers. And see all the homes they had. They had up some homes, antebellum homes and stuff.
You know what's interesting about this is that this was all done by from memory and by hand, and now you can go on Google, and you can see somebody.
The Green Room has education, rural roots of jazz, and black doctors, midwives, as well as
picture about things, information about St. Catherine Church. We also talk about our great jazz musicians. A lot of the musicians left from the South and went to the North, as well as Joe King Oliver. Joe King Oliver became very fond of Louis Armstrong, and he brought Louis Armstrong to Chicago with him. This is why they're so famous, because our people reach back and help the other one, as we are supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
This is Remarie Short. Remarie Short from Donaldsonville. He did the music for Ray Charles' record, I Got a Woman.
Mm.
We also have Bill Summers. He's from the town on the end of Donaldsonville called Aiden. Pink Panther theme song.
Hmm.
Here, he's from Donaldsonville. We have Plas Johnson. Plas Johnson is from Donaldsonville as well. He was born and raised here in Donaldsonville. Over here, we have a piano that Mrs. Sylvia Watkins, the home that we're in now, was her home. And this organ that sits here, she taught piano lessons. So we have this piano, this organ in our possession.
That's beautiful. Is it still operable?
No, it's not. We need some work done to it.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Now, I see this little...
Who house this was?
This is Sylvia Watkins, one of the retired teachers from here in Donaldsonville.
Oh, okay.
She was related to Dr. Brazier, Dr. Brazier's niece.
Oh, okay.
Dr. Brazier, one of the black doctors who had a pharmacy right down here on Railroad Avenue.
Oh, okay.
A pharmacy and a little, what do you call it, a little shop to go sit in and eat your, all of your float and everything?
Yeah, ice cream shop. Yeah. They used to call them candy shops, something like that.
Yes.
I can't think of the name of them, but I know what you're talking about.
Who was this guy?
This is Gilbert Haven. He was a veteran. A building committee.
Uh-huh.
Reverend R.P. Robinson. Chairman Carol and DJ Reddix, W. Kenner, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You know them?
I know where Kenner's at. I don't want to say his name after him, but
nice.
You never know. My first name is Gilbert.
Gilbert,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Might be related.
You never know.
Well, I bless her, but that's all you had is one name.
That's it. This is a portrait that Malika Favorite did. She lives in Geismar, but now she lives in New York.
Uh-huh.
But she always bring a group, a bus ride or a group of kids to the museum.
Oh.
Every summer she does.
What's her name?
Malika Favorite. M-A-L-A-I-K-A.
Now, she was a native of Donaldsonville?
No, she's from Geismar.
Oh, Geismar.
Yeah, she's from Geismar. And this was called a river preacher.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
This is an education. Well, all of this is education. These are pictures and quotes of Lemonville School. Lemonville School was a little school from down in Avon, down to Lemonville, down from Donaldsonville.
Uh-huh.
Oh, those are pictures. Mrs. Britton was one of the teachers that taught at Lemonville Schools. This is a new exhibit we are putting up. We haven't finished putting everything together, but we have some information on the computer that you can go on the internet.
Yeah, I saw you have quite a bit of information. The BBC, British Broadcasting also. So I feel honored and privileged to be here, because you've been in some good company.
I have. And I learned so much. And when I go to these different conferences and stuff, you know, I'm also one of LSU Master Gardeners that I travel and think to the conference and thing as well.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. So I like, we have a garden down, you know, down in the next block.
Now, how often do you have to?
Well, I haven't been, I had surgery last year, so I didn't go. But I'm trying to get in touch. I think I'm going to go this year.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Trying to make an arrangement to go this year. Because it's so informative and you learn so much.
Yeah, yeah, mm-hmm. I understand that. I have a young nephew who's going to be out here in March from San Francisco. And I just found out that every year they come down, he brings 30 children, 30 young adults with him. to build houses in New Orleans.
Oh,
Habitat for Houses.
Habitat House
yeah,
for Houses.
Yeah, they do that. So he's going to be here in March, and I hope that I can direct him out here to see some of this stuff here, because he's a pretty smart youngster.
I have a grandson. He lives in Lafayette now. He joined the National Guard, and he said that's what he did, part of their training, what they did when he went on his training. He worked with him at Habitat.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's a good thing. That's a good thing.
Yeah, that is. That really is. Mm-hmm. On this picture at the bottom is Principal E.C. Lane. He was principal at Bloor. I think it was 1949.
Mm-hmm.
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 And another picture is of Inspiration Vision of St. Catherine of Siena.
Now, what is over this? Is this medicine over here in the cabinet?
Yes.
That's Dr. Lori. This is the wall of Dr. Lori. When you say education, and also, this is the original medicine cabinet. These are his original books, and these are some of the stuff and things that he had.
Get out of here.
Is that
this
right?
This is his office building. We own the building down in Louisiana Square.
Uh-huh.
We use it now, my little great niece uses it as an office for recreation center. She's the recreation director for the Parish of Ascension.
And I also see up there,
this is the original, the museum.
Oh, the museum. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
This is his old phone that he had, and his number was 309. Just three numbers.
I remember the phones.
Yeah.
Well, not exactly, but I remember them.
Yeah.
I have it. They are, you know.
They're good in heaven.
Yes, they're good in heaven.
Mm-hmm. That's beautiful.
Yes. So we had
the pill crusher. Lord have mercy. The ligament. Oh.
That's long ligament.
Yes, indeed.
Those old people live by
and
that.
Stuff in that bottle that they give you to drink, Castoria, whatever.
Cloud Bethune spoke.
Okay.
This is Lori High School across on Walnut Street. Well, now it's named Dr. Martin Luther King. But this is where Mary McLeod Bethune, that's who's speaking up there now at Lori High School.
Mm.
Oh, okay.
And our young people.
Bethune. It was in her who opened the college.
Yes.
And, oh, gee,
yes.
That's the same person.
Mm-hmm. That's the same person.
Bethune College in Florida.
Florida. Mm-hmm. That's exactly right.
Okay.
And I told you about Dr. Lord already donating the money and thing for the school. And,
right.
You
know, right.
And when the young people went to school at Lori, they used to call him boss, Mr. Martin, they had to wear ties. See, this is where they're working. He taught them carpentry, you know, work and everything.
Mm-hmm.
So they had to wear ties and stuff. He taught them how to build furniture, school furniture, homes and stuff.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah.
That's a good trade.
That's right. When you finished from Lori High School, you could go out and get a job because you were trained.
Hands-on skills, and that's better than anything. They sending them to school, all that money.
Now, when a black person does something, it's unique and it's well done. And they do it because they love it. Exactly. And when you do what you love, you're going to put your best in it.
Absolutely.
Your whole heart in it.
And the white man going to want you to do it because he knows it's going to be done
right.
And it's going to cost him less.
Thank you.
Now, these are doctors up here from...
Black doctors of the River Road. We have midwives. Mm-hmm. This is Dr. Isidore from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Dr. Isidore is a native of Gramercy. Of Gramercy. He was among the first African-American doctors in St. James Parish. He was born in Alexandria and Emile Isidore and was born on December 19, 1883. He was one of the first graduates of Southern University in New Orleans and received his medical degree from Meharry Medical School in Nashville, Tennessee in 1907. He was licensed to practice medicine in Tennessee and Louisiana. He established his practice in Lutcher in 1908 and served both St. James Parish residents
and St. John Parish resident. He was very well known in Lutcher, Gramercy, Bashery, Eggard, and Lucy. He had a reputation for never refusing service to anyone, black or white. Like many other African-American physicians of the time, he received little or no pay for his low-income patients and often paid for medication they needed. He was an active civic, religious, and political leader and was a lifetime member of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Dr. Isidore was on the medical staff of the St. James Parish Hospital and a member of St. James Board of Health. Louisiana, there is a highway named after Dr. Dean.
So were there any like black hospitals around here?
No, the only one was in New Orleans. Uh-huh. We didn't have any here.
Charity Hospital mm-hmm. was the only hospital.
excuse me.
Flint Goodrich.
Yeah, Flint Goodrich.
Flint this was is the black Dr. Ulysses hospital.
S. Grant uh-huh. Daly. Dr. Daly was born in Donaldsonville. Lived in Donaldsonville, Louisiana in 1885. He graduated from Northwestern University Medical School in 1906, where he was appointed a demonstrator of anatomy. He served as a surgical assistant for 4 years, 1908-1912, to Dr. Daniel Hale Williams, who performed the first successful open-heart surgery. Dr. Daly studied in London, Paris, Vienna, and in 1926 set up his own hospital and sanitarium in Chicago. His name soon became associated with some of the outstanding achievements being made in anatomy and surgery. For many years, he was an associate editor of the Journal of the National Medical Association. Dr. Daly traveled around the world in 1933 under the sponsorship of the International College of Surgeons, of which he was a founder fellow in 1951 and again in 1953. The U.S. Department sent him to Pakistan, India, Cleon, and Africa as a much-respected doctor and as a goodwill ambassador. A year later, he was named honorary consul to Haiti. Dr. Daly probably had more impact overseas for medicine and for Americans than any other black scientist of his time. Huh. Railroad Avenue, uh-huh. but she was his niece.
Oh, okay. Uh-huh. So they were all basically family members.
Yeah, they were family. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. She was a graduate of Tuskegee Institute and Wiley College. Miss Sylvia was a teacher and a principal of a Rosenwald school known as the Modest Elementary School. She taught piano lessons in this house and was the organist at St. Peter United Methodist Church, which is around the corner.
And this is the organ that she played over here.
Yes.
Folks.
And she taught, yes.
And that is the organ.
Ain't that something?
That is.
A little bit out of focus, but that is it. Okay. I did a documentary, basically from the Black Enterprise Network about the roots of jazz and in Southern Louisiana. Basically people that came out of New Orleans.
Yes.
Like my homeboy here, Louis Armstrong.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah. You know, I think the song that he made that I'm most impressed by is What a Wonderful World.
Oh,
I love that record.
I know it.
Yeah, that is a beautiful song. Yes. So all these people are from around this area?
Around this area.
Yeah, okay.
And Mr. Clayvon Williams, he taught a lot of people to play music. He was the only PS. But this used to be Laura McBain. She's a band of dancers.
Uh-huh.
Lydia Dandridge was the band director of that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, black people wasn't no dummies as they want you to be.
That's right. That's exactly right. And to me, it could be put forth more effort not to teach our children what they need to know.
Yeah, because they're ashamed of their own.
What they have done.
Yeah, but they, like you say, they don't know enough of the history to go back and say, well, I mean, and a lot of people that puts you down are people who ancestors of some of these famous people and don't have sense enough to even know it. Or realize it. I mean, y'all come off, especially when they go by the names, all y'all come off the same plantation if you got the same name. You just got to follow down, trivia down to find out where your roots at, you know, and you'll eventually find that out.
And this is on an accordion?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. It was donated by Alvin Albert's family.
I see you got some instruments here in the
yes.
Base.
Yes. Mm-hmm. You got the wooden flute.
I tried the saxophone when I was in elementary school.
Oh, my brother played the sax.
It didn't work out too well for me.
Oh, you gotta have some heavy, hefty lungs. Well, who this,
Okay, I just want to remind you that coming up on the 28th of February, which is the third Saturday of the month, at the Hamilton Recreation Center in San Francisco, we'll be having the Black History Celebration, and we would appreciate it if you would come by and check us out. It starts about 12 or 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and we're going to have some, hopefully, entertainment for you, and we'll have some young people participating. Also, we will have some wonderful food, and it's all free. We will accept donations if you care to do so, but you don't have to come with a donation. You just have to come and bring yourself and enjoy the afternoon. We've been doing it now for the last 4 years. And it's been an enjoyment. Last year we were able to give away some scholarship prizes. This year I'm not really sure about it, but we'll see what happens. We do want to encourage young people to write about what they feel about themselves and their past, because we feel, as has been said in the past, your past determines your future. And I know you heard that cliche before, but I honestly believe it's true. If you don't know where you came from, you don't know where you're going. In the meantime, we hope that you have enjoyed our presentation. And as I said before, we couldn't put all of this together in one show, so there will be a follow-up to this show where we hope to show you the remainder of the footage that was taken while we were visiting in New Orleans. This has been the Domino Theory television program, and it was produced by the San Francisco Domino Club, and you can reach us at sfdominoclub@gmail.com. You can also go to our website at sfdominoclub.net, which I need to talk to these people about updating real soon, but I digress. Anyway, God bless you. Take care. Have a good one. And thank you so much for tuning in. And we hope that you'll get a chance to see the other part of what we put together in terms of this particular program and its Black history from the River Road African American Museum located down in Donaldsonville, Louisiana. Thank you very much and have a good one.